100 South Kyrene Road, Tempe. We regularly meet on the second and fourth Tuesdays of the month. However, there's only one board meeting in July, October, and December. All meetings begin at 7 p.m. We welcome community involvement and encourage people to come to board meetings and be involved in our community. School board meetings are held in public to conduct the business of the district board meeting. The district board meetings will be streamed live on the internet and then posted on the Kyrene YouTube channel, which can be accessed by going to our website at kyrene.org and clicking on the YouTube icon at the bottom left side. Board agendas may be obtained from the district office and the Kyrene website 24 hours in advance of each board meeting. Our superintendent, David Schauer, board secretary, Cindy Miller, senior leadership, lead principals, directors, and interested citizens are here with us tonight. Board President Michelle Hurst will be taking part in this meeting via speakerphone. As vice president, I'm acting as meeting moderator this evening. Please join me in a moment of silence. Please stand. Following a moment of silence, Abby Steinman is going to do the Pledge of Allegiance for us.
Please remain standing. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Abby. Next is roll call. Will board members please state their name for the record?
Ellen Chama.
Bernadette Coggins.
Ross Robb.
Michelle Hirsch.
Beth Brazel. Next on the agenda is a preview and approval of the agenda. Are there any changes to this evening's agenda, including consent agenda items?
I have one change. I would like to take item 8.7 off the consent agenda for this evening. One of you asked for more information on that, so we'll take that one off and bring that forward probably the next time.
Okay, may I have a motion to approve the consent agenda as amended?
Move to approve the consent the agenda as amended.
Second.
Okay, there's a motion by Mr. Robb, second by Ms. Coggins. All in favor say aye.
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 Motion passes 5-0. Next on the agenda is superintendent's briefing. Dr. Schauer.
Thank you, Madam President. Madam Moderator, I should say. Sorry about that. I wanted to congratulate board members on the most recent election. Ellen, I want to thank you for your 4 years of service and many, many years of teaching in Kyrene. Your experience and wisdom has really been valuable to this team. And I want to congratulate Ross Robb on his reelection to the board and Michelle Hirsch to her reelection. And also to our newest board member, John King, who will be joining this team. So congratulations to all for your service. I wanted to mention that we began 2 days of training this week on the Marzano Leadership Evaluation System. So you know we've been working on the teacher evaluation system. Today we began the training on the leadership evaluation, and it's 2 full days. Today was our first, and we're coming in groups for this. The system has 5 domains, and so you might remember the teacher system. It's similar. It has a very similar kind of framework. It's a little bit easier to understand. The domains, as you might imagine, this is going to sound like it makes sense. The first one is a data-driven focus on student achievement. The second one is continuous improvement of instruction. The third one is a guaranteed and viable curriculum. The fourth one is cooperation and collaboration. And the fifth one is on school climate. And so then within each one of those domains, there are elements, just like in the teacher system. And we can start talking about what we expect in terms of leadership in this district and have a common language. So I think we're pretty excited about the potential for the system. It's really going to help us, and it ties right into the teacher evaluation system. So it all will work very seamlessly once we all learn about it. The other thing I thought I would mention is that we are currently doing the Gallup Q12 survey. This is our third year. The window is open until November 19th, and Dr. Knight has been reminding all of our staff to fill out that survey. We've been seeing reports every other day or so on how each school is doing and how each department is doing in terms of response rate. And you might remember that we had our initial year was 74% response. Last year was 77% response. This year our goal is 80% response. But I told everyone our real goal is 100% response. So I think we're on our way to reaching our goal, and hopefully we'll exceed it. And we'll have a report on the Gallup survey in January. That's when the organization will be able to analyze all of our data, come and teach it to us, and then we can start sharing it with the organization. The last thing I thought I'd mention is that my walkthroughs with principals continue. And so I'm working alongside our principals as they walk through teachers' classrooms and use the Marzano teaching framework to give them feedback. And my feedback, of course, doesn't count. But I think a lot of times the teachers want to know what I think. So I'm trying to find some other ways maybe to share that with them so that they feel comfortable having me come into the classroom. But I have found it extremely valuable. And I really enjoy the conversations with our principals about teaching and learning, you know, and it's more focused than I've ever seen it. So I think we're making some really good strides forward with this system. So that's my report. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Schauer. Next is around the district with the governing board. Do any governing board members have anything they want to share? Ms. Shama?
Well, David took mine, but I want to congratulate John King. He ran a good race. I ran a rotten one. So I wish him the best of luck, and I wish the boards the best of luck.
Thank you, Mrs. Shama. Mrs. Hirsch, did you want to share? Oh, sorry, Ms. Coggins, did you? Okay. Mrs. Hirsch, did you have something you wanted to share?
Yeah, just real quickly, I wanted to add that, like most of us, I was up most of the night on election night. But the morning after, I went over to Monta Vista, and the Monta Vista Mountain Warrior Choir performed for all the students. They're actually performing tonight. That's not where I am, but they're actually performing tonight. And it was such a fantastic performance by that choir. They are so animated and expressive and sing beautifully, and so I just wanted to share that was very encouraging after a long campaign and election night to actually go to a school, see kids, and I just wanted to share about that. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Hirsch. Next on the agenda is 6.01, procedures to speak to the governing board. Members of the audience may address any item not on the agenda. Please fill out the blue form and submit it to the board secretary. Speakers will be limited to 3 minutes each. State statute prohibits the governing board from discussing any item that is not on the agenda, but we do listen and request that staff follow up on any concerns. Are there any blue cards this evening? The timer located on the TV screens will prompt you when you have 15 seconds left, and again when your time is up. Rob Haas. And please state your name for the record.
Thank you. Members of the board, Mr. Schauer, Rob Haas. Live on Jasper Drive. My kids are graduates of Manitas Elementary and Pueblo Middle School. But tonight I'm here as a scout leader. We have our scouts here who are working on their citizenship pin. And so we've brought them, all of them live in Kyrene District. Most of them go to Kyrene schools, although not all of them do. We've asked them to come ready to address you tonight and make one comment about something they like about their school and one comment of a suggested improvement that they would have for you at your school. And so it is a school night. When we're done, we will stick around as long as we're able to, but we will excuse ourselves before your meeting's over. We appreciate all that you do for these kids in the Kyrene District. Thank you.
Thank you. Darren Ludwig.
One thing I like about my school is that they have very nice teachers, and one thing that I would change is to get a new gifted teacher.
Thank you. Ben Hardy.
My name is Ben Hardy, and I am in fifth grade at Kyrene Traditional Academy. One thing I like about the school is the uniforms, because in the morning I don't have to choose from a whole bunch of stuff. And one thing that I would change is with the Spark program, if, like, after we're finished, if we could just go out.
Thank you. Connor Zook.
My name is Connor Zook. I'm in fifth grade, and I go to Kyrene de las Manitas. And one thing I like about the school is that they say that you're in second grade, and you learn a new thing, and you go to third grade, and they reteach that so you can remember it. And the thing I would like to change is more playground equipment.
Thank you. Tyler Rollins.
Hello, I'm Tyler Rollins, and I go to Center for Educational Excellence. And what I like about my school is that all the teachers are really intelligent, and that I would like to, well, something I would change about my school would probably be the math teacher, because they use the specialist teachers for math teachers, since I'm in a more higher math class. I have the art teacher as my math teacher, so yeah.
Thank you. And Cal Gibson.
Hi, my name is Cal Gibson. I'm homeschooled, but I've been to Kyrene School District. I think it's pretty cool the way it is. I don't really think there's anything to change.
Thank you.
You get the unvarnished version of it all here, but thank you for listening and your attention. I hope you'll consider the boys' comments, good and suggested improvements. Thank you.
Thank you. Next is board members' reports. Mr. Ross? Sorry.
Thank you. I will dismiss that to the nervousness of being the moderator. The report that I've got is on the East Valley Consortium meeting, which we hosted right here in this room a couple of weeks ago. The East Valley Consortium is a group of school districts from the East Valley, thus the name, the East Valley Consortium. And it was pretty well attended. Dr. Schauer and Board President Michelle Hirsch made some lovely opening remarks to welcome everybody to the district. And Sodexo provided Mexican food, as I recall, which I think everybody appreciated. And there were really two agenda items on the agenda for the consortium meeting. One was Chuck Essigs from the Arizona School Board Association, spoke to the group about some of the facts and myths about Arizona school district funding, and kind of did a breakdown of federal, state, and local revenues, and I think educated everyone a little bit about some of the facts and myths about Arizona funding. A lot of what we believe about Arizona funding is true, and some of them maybe not quite as true as we might have thought. Then Jeff Peters led the group in a technologically savvy version of a kind of a survey of the districts about how everybody had dealt with communication with their communities and how everybody dealt with budget balancing strategies, which certainly is going to be relevant as we move forward in the current fiscal year. So I think everybody enjoyed the meeting. We certainly got good feedback from the other school districts, and I think Kyrene showed itself very well.
Can I just add something? Mm-hmm. They had delicious non-alcoholic margaritas.
Thank you. The next item on our agenda is Rachel's Challenge. Dr. Schauer.
Thank you. This is an initiative we're very excited about, and Kelly Alexander is going to tell you all about it with some other people, I think.
Absolutely. Good evening, Madam President, members of the Governing Board, Dr. Schauer, and community. Just 12 weeks ago, members of the Tempe Diablos, Board Member Ross Robb, and several members of our school and prevention staff had an opportunity to hear about a unique program focusing on kindness. Among many others, Ms. Jaminaki and Mr. Robb expressed interest in bringing this program to Kyrene for the benefit of our students as soon as absolutely possible. I'm happy to report that thanks to the Tempe Diablos and the Kyrene Foundation, this program will be able to be offered in all six of our middle schools by the end of January. Rachel's Challenge is just one of Kyrene's prevention programs that are designed to support student achievement. Programs like Minitown, Drug Prevention, and Character Counts help to create positive school environments that promote kindness and personal accountability. It's my pleasure tonight to introduce Ms. Jaminaki, principal of Kyrene Middle School, to speak about Rachel's Challenge and how it went at Kyrene Middle School.
When you're so close with your family, you really feel like you know everything about them. But after we lost Rachel, it was like we discovered this whole side of her that we had never seen before. The things that she wrote about were just so deep and so profound, especially for someone her age. Rachel really did care about other people. She understood the power that a simple act of kindness can have.
I have this theory that if one person can go out of their way to show compassion, then it will start a chain reaction of the same.
You know, at a time when most kids in high school are just trying to fit in, she just wanted to be herself and encouraged others to do the same.
Don't let your character change color with your environment. Find out who you are and let it stay its true color.
Rachel had a lot of big dreams for her life, and she wasn't afraid to set high goals, even if they seemed impossible.
How many of us know what we really want and go after it? How many of us have enough trust, strength, and faith to believe that we could do the impossible?
Even though Rachel was my younger sister, I look up to her. She taught me that some people live more life in 17 years than some people will in 71. And through her writings, she's inspired all of us to make each and every day count.
Well, good evening to everyone, Governing Board members and Dr. Schauer and guests and Boy Scouts? Boy Scouts, you did a great job. So good evening to parents as well. Again, my name is Jaminaki, and I always say I'm the very proud principal of Kyrene Middle School. And in August, as Mrs. Alexander talked about, we were approached to visit this presentation, Rachel's Challenge. So we went over to Marcos Teniza to watch it. And what we learned was that you don't watch Rachel's Challenge, but you experience it. It was quite moving that day. There were several adults in the room, and I can collectively say we were all pretty much mess by watching this presentation. So our prevention specialist, Mr. Khalid Jenkins, and myself approached, obviously, the Tempe Diablos and said we would love to be able to do this. So I would like to especially thank our Kyrene Schools Foundation and Amanda Hamm, who's been completely instrumental in organizing all of this, and also Mr. Russ Torrance, who's in the back of the room, by the way, from the Tempe Diablos, who was very instrumental as well as bringing us to that. So as what Rachel challenges, if you can imagine 600 middle school students in an assembly at one time with not a peep coming out of anyone's mouth, they're not moving, and they are completely engaged and glued to this presentation. What the nice thing is about this whole Rachel Challenge thing, and as we all know, we've been in schools for a long time, and we've seen lots and lots of programs. This is all very much ground level, base level, and it's all from the students. It's not the teachers teaching it all. This is ground root level, and what happened that day was we asked students to be able to come to an afternoon training, and we only could take 100 because we could only fit in the 100, and we had over 300 students want to volunteer for that training. because I'm not only with Rachel's Challenge, you get a four club, and that's Friends of Rachel. So we'll, at KMS, we started a four club in all three grade levels. And what that club is, there's these amazing young ladies behind us is going to talk about a little bit more, but it's really about just that day-to-day kindness, that one act that you're going to be nice to one person, and then the next person, and the next person. And I'll tell you, just the language at KMS has changed amongst adults, amongst students, and from students to students. It's helped us with when we have students' interaction, it may not be quite positive, we bring forth the five things that Rachel challenged us to that day. And if we've got adults that may not be having we might be having a rough day, then we bring Rachel's Challenge into thinking about we're still here and she's not. So it's been an amazing experience. So I would like to introduce three ladies that this has really changed their lives. And we have Shania Nelson. Addie Grice and Abby Steinman. And they're going to talk to you guys, because you don't want to hear me. They're going to talk to you guys about the life-changing experience that this has made for them, not only just at school, but also in their personal experience.
Good evening. Kindness, something Rachel believed everyone in the world could have and share with others. Rachel was one to go out of her way and pass on kindness. She gave me the message that everyone is different, and that is okay. I myself used to prejudge. We all do. And it's okay. But look for the best in others, and you just might start a chain reaction. Speak words of kindness to receive some in return. In her paper, it says, "Compassion is the greatest form of love humans have to offer." According to Webster's Dictionary, compassion means a feeling of sympathy for others' misfortune. Her definition of compassion is forgiving, loving, helping, leading, and showing mercy for others. She had this theory that if one person can go out of their way to show compassion, then it will start a chain reaction of the same. People will never know how far a little kindness can go. So be yourself, and kindness can go on a long run. To believe is to have a state of mind. How many of us have enough trust, strength, and faith to pass on to others? Kindness is something Rachel gave to me, and I share with others every day and to the rest to come. Tomorrow is not a promise, but a chance to change yourself, your community, and lives of others. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Abby Steinman. Rachel's Challenge has changed my way of thinking. It's changed my teachers, my friends, my family. The point of the assembly that touched me the most was when the brother talked about how his sister died, and their last words to each other were in the car, where they were mean. She wasn't mean nor rude. She was more than kind. She was dedicated to changing people's perspectives on their lives. Her believings on life were so profound at her age. She understood what one act of kindness could do. Most high school students cared about what people thought of them. Rachel was more concerned about being herself. Rachel's beliefs were, don't let your character judge color with your environment. Find out who you are and let it stay its true color. She also believed and asked, do you have enough faith to believe that we could do the impossible? First impressions are deceitful. I know my friends were changed because of Rachel. I've made many new friends because we don't judge each other at first impressions anymore. Rachel asked, how many of us enough trust, strength, and faith? Did you ever ask them what their goal in life is? What kind of past they came from? Did they experience love or did they experience hate? Did you look into their soul and not just at their appearance? Rachel didn't care what people thought. Until you know them and not just their appearance, you have no right to judge them. I personally believe in some way you will change the world, and you've already changed the thinking of someone. Reactions of each other's kindness is what makes the world what it is today, and it is the future of tomorrow. Thank you.
Okay. I did Rachel's five challenges. She went by these five rules that she pretty much lived by. look for the best in others. Rachel tried to become friends with everyone, no matter what their action or feeling was at that time. Rachel said, give someone three chances before you judge them. In my life, people judge you from a bad first impression. Rachel did not. Treat others the way you want to be treated. Rachel believed that if people saw others being nice, it would start a chain reaction. She tried being kind to everyone she met in hope of being kind to others at school. People judge by appearance. She wanted people to treat, to treat people the way the person wants them self-treated by others. Rachel Joy Scott said, I have this theory that if one person can go out of their way to show compassion, then it will start a chain reaction of the same. Choose positive influences. Rachel encouraged others to be themselves. She had a lot of big dreams for her life. She wasn't afraid to set high goals for herself. Rachel chose to be helpful to others and thought, how many of us know what we really want and go after it? At my school, people choose to help out with kids or teachers. These are the good and positive influences that Rachel put upon these kids. Speak words of kindness. Rachel spoke with a softness to her voice. She spoke of kindness and loyalty, trust and compassion, caring and love. I try to be nice to others, and so do my friends. Forgive yourself and others. Forgive yourself of your past. They had us close our eyes and think about all the good we've done. Think about that one thing we can't let go of. Forgive and forget, and we do the same with others. Rachel believed tomorrow was not a promise, but a chance. And we decided to take Rachel's challenge. Thank you.
They're amazing writers, aren't they? Great job, ladies. Are there any questions?
I was just going to say congratulations. It's a great program. But, you know, even before the program of Rachel's Challenge, the schools always had compassionate children in them and children that stood up for the underdog. And I just have to tell you a little bit about Apprende and Cielo and my grandson who has Downs. And I could not imagine a nicer, more caring children, as I know you are, that go out of their way to be a buddy to disabled children, that make sure they're not wandering the halls and getting lost. I just think the five pillars of Rachel's Challenge would help every adult and every child. And I wish more people felt secure enough in their own skin to do what you guys are doing. Thank you.
Thank you so much for giving us the opportunity. Oh, I'm sorry, Mr. Rob, would you like to say something?
You know, I had the honor to attend the assembly at Kyrene Middle School, and it really was pretty amazing. You know, there were 500 or 600 students in each of the assemblies, and you know, at the first assembly, I watched the presentation. At the second assembly, I kind of spent more time looking out in the audience and watching the students, and it was a pretty riveting. You know, it's interesting to see 500 or 600 students be as riveted as they were for as long as they were, and it's pretty obvious that it was making an impact. And you know, I just think that we really do need to recognize, as everybody knows, there is no money in the school district for these kinds of programs. So you know, I think we really do need to express our thanks both to the Tempe Diablos who brought this to our attention and to the Kyrene Foundation who has agreed to pick up the other 50% that the Diablos did not. It's also worth mentioning that I think November 27th, 28th, 29th is at Altadena, Akimal, and Apprende. And then in January is Centennial in Pueblo. And there will be opportunities for companies and individuals in our community or even outside our community to participate in sponsoring these presentations, and I know some sponsorship letters went out today. So this is a true community event that involves both the school district, the foundation, the Diablos, and anyone else that would like to participate. So thank you to all who made this a reality.
And I'm sorry. Go ahead.
I was going to say, Mrs. Sharma.
Oh, do you want to say how this program began?
Oh, you mean where Rachel? Yeah, yeah. Rachel was the first young lady that was shot in Columbine. She was actually outside the building, and she was the first one that died.
Mrs. Hirsch, did you want to add anything? Okay. Well, I want to thank you. You three did a wonderful job. Thank you very much. And I'm looking forward to seeing the presentation at Apprende after Thanksgiving, because it looks like a great program. And I agree with Mr. Rob that it's, you know, we want to thank the foundation as well for bringing this to us. So thank you so much.
And I think it's been especially, we've never had a program to go across all six middle schools at the same time like this. And we've already got some ideas about the Rachel's Walk on 420 and things like that. So for us to have a district-wide program like this is going to be a huge impact for many thousands of children. So again, we so thank everybody for their support.
Thank you. Next on the agenda is 7.03, Kyrene Parent Summit. Dr. Schauer.
Yes, this is also going to be Mrs. Alexander. And this was a first-time event and I think a huge success. And I said it that night, and I just have to say it again. You know, the staff that you work with is incredible. To pull something like this off was amazing. It's been a dream to do something like this, and we actually made it happen. So thank you so much. And now you can kind of tell us all about it. So sure. Thanks again for what you've done.
Well, again, it is a fun night for us to celebrate many wonderful things that are happening here in Kyrene. As you know, one of the values of community education and outreach services is to engage parents and students of all ages by providing opportunities for them to learn and to grow in numerous ways. As the board has expressed in the past, you would like for us to provide increased opportunities for parent training. And on Thursday, November 8th, 86 parents and 92 students gathered at Kyrene Middle School to participate in the inaugural Parent Summit in Kyrene. Programs like this are made possible through the generous support of community business partners through our sponsorship program. The Parent Summit was supported by the Kyrene Foundation, Babo Italian Eatery, and Hunt and Caraway Architects. And I'm happy to announce or introduce Ms. Amanda Hamm, the program manager for Kyrene's prevention programs, and she is going to share some of the highlights from that evening.
Madam President, members of the board, Dr. Schauer, and our Kyrene community, I am so proud to share about the results of the first ever Kyrene Parent Summit. The Kyrene Prevention Services has partnered with many organizations over the past 10 years to offer trainings to the district office and at our school sites. But what makes our Kyrene Parent Summit unique is that for the first time, Prevention Services has partnered with many organizations to host a variety of parent education sessions on the same night with dinner and child care provided. At the Kyrene Parent Summit this past Thursday evening, which was hosted at Kyrene Middle School, parents were able to attend two different sessions, one at the 6:15 hour and another at the 7:15 hour, with six different parent education options available each hour. Additionally, dinner was provided for families at 5:15, which was sponsored by Babo Italian Eatery, and children were able to attend enrichment sessions for the evening while their parents attended classes. With many thanks to our sponsorships from the Hunt and Caraway Architects, Babo Italian Eatery, and the Kyrene Foundation, parents were able to attend the evening for only $5 per adult and no charge for children. We worked very hard with our sponsors to make the evening affordable for all parents so that no parent would be excluded from attending. We're so excited to have, for our very first event, 86 parents attend the summit with 96 children, and we also had about 30 volunteers assisting that evening to make sure everything was running smoothly. At check-in, parents were provided a bag from our sponsors with additional information about upcoming parent trainings in the community, information from our sponsors, and a complimentary magazine from the MASC organization, which is Mother's Awareness of School-Age Children. And our bags were printed by the Kyrene Print Shop. And I stuck one up there with Beth. She said she'd be my Vanna White to show you our bags. Thank you. Thank you, guys. Great bags with lots of information so that parents who wanted additional information from our sponsors and our vendors about upcoming trainings, thank you, could get more information and continue their parent education. I think a lot of the sessions were eye-opening for parents and leaves them wanting more. Our feedback from parents has been very positive. The Community Education Department has received many phone calls asking when the next Parent Summit will be and has shared that their children enjoyed the evening as well. Additionally, many of our presenters have offered the compliments of the evening and offered their services again free of charge. Prevention Services does look forward to hosting another Kyrene Parent Summit in the spring. A small team made this evening a great success. We had two Prevention Services members, two dedicated Kyrene parents who helped me secure presenters, vendors, sponsors, and volunteers, with a special thank you here to Carrie Brown, who was a Lomas parent, who was not only part of the committee and volunteered at check-in, but has also joined me to speak tonight on her perspective on attending as a parent.
Good evening, Dr. Schauer, members of the board and community. I actually just stumbled upon this committee. I was volunteering at the Resource Center, and Amanda pulled me in one day, and I was very happy to get involved. And this is exactly the kind of thing as a parent that I am always looking for. And I think most of the parents who were attending felt the same way. I think we could have gone on for another couple hours. I attended, first I'll say that the childcare opportunities were fabulous. My son was so happy to get to do 2 hours of athletes in training in the dark, partly outside. And my younger son got to play with some kids that he knew and meet new kids and hang out with, I don't know if they're teenagers or college-age kids, but they love hanging out with older kids. And then not having to have dinner, it was very affordable. And I attended the middle school session, which is still a ways off for me, but I'm very interested in middle school. I learned a lot, and I actually think you probably could have had a packed house if you did a similar thing at every middle school, or, you know, do it again. I would encourage that to happen again. And then I attended the session with Mitzi Epstein, the former board member here, who did a great job of talking about how parents can get involved at their local school site. And the parents who attended, I think they got quite a bit out of it because she does a great job of talking about, you know, if you have a problem, where do you start? Don't go barging into the principal's office. Talk to your teacher, and things that we parents don't always think of. And so that was very helpful, and that session could have gone on longer. So thank you. I was really happy to be a part of it, and I look forward to the next one.
I just wanted to say again a thank you to all of our sponsors and all of our presenters. We had so many presenters. I know they're up on the board. I want to thank Bernadette for attending a session and for Michelle Hirsch for moderating the middle school session. It was wonderful to have a large group of support from not only our community, but for our PSC, our Parent Superintendent Council, and also the governing board. So thank you all for attending and for your support of the events. Are there any questions?
You know, I really just want to thank you guys for doing this. I mean, it's something that we've, you know, we've talked with Nancy and with what's going on with Tempe Union, and how can we not reinvent the wheel, but really do something at different levels, because there's so much out there, and I think parents just don't know, and they're hungry for it, and we want to know about internet safety, which that's the class that I didn't get to take and I want to take. Kelly and I are mortified about all the different substances that are out there, and as I was going down the list, thank goodness Amanda said just go that way, because I came running in, but there were so many great classes, and it was a very robust list of what you really wanted to take everything. And what's great is that I would go, if this was at other schools, I would make sure that I went to every single campus across Kyrene to the different middle schools. So I would love to see this replicated. I think every middle school and every community at each one would, especially after the success that we had at the Kyrene. And I just remember my son was practicing football over here, and there were so many cars. I'm like, what's going on? The parking lot was packed. You couldn't even get a place to park. So great job. I missed the dinner, but thank you to the community who did sponsor the Babbo, and I absolutely love this magazine. If you ever had a chance to go through and read it, there's so much great information. But it was great, and thanks you guys for doing it.
Thank you.
Mrs. Hirsch?
Hi, thank you. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
Okay. This was a fantastic and fun parent education opportunity. Thank you to everyone who helped put this together, and Carrie for asking me to moderate one of the sessions. In the session I moderated, it was fifth grade to middle school transitions, and we had 25 parents in that room asking really good questions, and the panel of principals gave great answers. I agree. I think it could have gone on for another hour because there was such good discussion and questions. And I am just so impressed with the way it was organized, the way it was set up. Thank you to the community and business sponsors. This really was fantastic. And I'll say, on one hand, I'm thankful that my kids are grown and I don't have to worry about internet safety and dating and all of that. But as a board member, I'm very thankful that we were able to provide this for families, and I look forward to doing this again because I heard a lot of feedback that parents went to one or two of the sessions, but there were other sessions that they wanted to attend as well. So thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Michelle. Thank you.
Next on the agenda is 7.04, Implementation of the Art and Science of Teaching Framework. Dr. Schauer.
Thank you. Dr. Taylor will be talking about this. This is our attempt to bring this into your reality so you can see how it really works. And we've been talking about this for a while, so I'll turn it over to Dr. Taylor. Thank you.
Good evening, Madam Vice President, members of the board, Dr. Schauer. It's my pleasure to speak with you a little bit this evening. My intent is just to give you a little brief update on how the implementation is going, some of the things that have taken place, and then to give you a little taste of what the eye observation tool is all about. I believe that Ms. Brazil had the opportunity to practice that in a classroom or two with a principal. And I would invite governing board members, if you're interested in having that actual experience of walking around with a school leader, please let Cindy know, because we can make arrangements for you to have that opportunity, because there's nothing like seeing it live. So
I agree. I think the hands-on was just wonderful, so I appreciate
so
that.
So you'll get an abbreviated type of version of that this evening, just a little bit of the practice that principals had before actually engaging, and our other school leaders before actually engaging in this process. But to give you a little overview, just as a reminder, where the teacher evaluation system includes now student achievement data as 40% and teacher performance as 60%. That 40% has already been downloaded into the system, so teachers know that portion of their evaluation, and we made a decision, that would be the teacher evaluation design team, made a decision to use district-wide data this first year because we don't have individual classroom teacher data for all teachers, although we're working on those assessments. And so every teacher's data in the system is either provides them with the ranking of effective or highly effective based on their school achievement at this time. I'm going to spend a little time this evening, though, also talking to you about that 60% performance. Some of the things that have changed with evaluation, just to remind us, evaluation used to be an event. A teacher went into a meeting with a principal or their supervisor with their evidence from the portfolio and things that they wanted to share with their principal, and it took place in a meeting of an hour or something like that. Now that we have ongoing data collection that results in a teacher's evaluation, teachers still meet with their supervisor, they still bring evidence of their planning and talk about student achievement, but they are also receiving feedback for walkthroughs and observations that all go into the system. And when the evaluation period closes, there'll be a final score rather than the evaluation being a one sit-down meeting. There are frequent walkthrough visits now, and that's different than what we've done before, that go into that evaluation. Another thing that changed in the statute that you may not be aware of is that every teacher is now required to have two formal observations. It used to be just our T-3 teachers or those with less than 3 years' experience, but now all teachers are required to have two. You need to realize that's an increased expectation for teachers, but a significant increase in the job responsibilities of all our building leaders who now are spending time with two formal observations for everyone. So we've upped the responsibility of our leaders in that. We now have elements instead of standards, and we have rating scales. You're going to see an example of that this evening, and you're going to see a little bit of the iObservation software. We've also introduced collaborative walkthroughs. There are 25 people in this building who've been trained in the system who are each matched with a school who go out and walk through with that building leader or those building leaders on a regular basis. And then Dr. Schauer and I are also trained, and we're going out and meeting with principals in every school and participating with them across the district. So we're having lots of opportunities for people to have conversations about what they're seeing in classrooms. Our regional lead principals are also structuring walkthroughs with their regions on a monthly basis. So there was a lot of opportunity for working together on this, which helps us with our reliability. During the learning and practice phase, which has come to a close, our administrators participated each in 58 and a half hours of training. That's actual seat time in learning about this system. That doesn't count all the practice they've done in their buildings during that practice phase, as well as about every principal's meeting, assistant principal's meeting, we're continuing to practice and work together. So many, many hours of training have gone into this system. We did not require that teachers attend the Art and Science of Teaching workshop, but we encouraged them to do that, and we did ask that they learn the Art and Science of Teaching, whether that was through a book study or an independent study or taking the class. And we've had at least 713 teachers at this point participate, about three quarters of our teachers, and we continue to offer that opportunity for teachers. Each school has a classroom practice mentor or more than one who are trained in the instrument, who are there as the support person for teachers, the go-to person that isn't their evaluator they can go and ask questions of and get support from those folks. During our learning and practice phase, our administrators conducted well over 3,000 walkthroughs of classrooms, probably more than we did last year in total. So we've been very, very busy being in classrooms. We've also provided a lot of video and written communication to teachers. I'm going to talk a little bit more about that in a moment. And then solicited two-way, we had a lot of communication two-way and solicited feedback. I know as governing board members, you're very interested in how we communicate and that we do that regularly. The teacher evaluation and design team has a website where people, our teachers and staff, can continue to put feedback on that website. At every single meeting, we come back to the website feedback, we review it, we identify things we need to do in terms of ongoing communication. So that's really been a nice cycle for communication. The teacher evaluation design team and the superintendent have both done videos that have given information about this system. So a lot of regular communication going. Dr. Schauer has included information in his bulletin. We've had surveys. We've had frequently asked questions that have gone out to teachers. And then staff meetings, our leadership team meetings, and the KEA has had meetings that have featured this topic as an opportunity to learn and share information. And then principals are using their school newsletters to their staff to continue to give feedback. And I give the principals and assistant principals a leadership memo each week, and we update in that memo as well what's happening and give continued information. For the component, the performance component, which is the 60% of the evaluation, there are four areas we look at. We used to have six areas. These are just collapsed into four in this tool. The first one is classroom strategies and behaviors, and those are the 41 observable elements in the evaluation. We're going to look at those tonight. And then we also look at planning and preparing, reflecting on teaching, the collaboration and professionalism of our teachers, which is something we've always done. And Mrs. Sharma, you've had that experience as a teacher being evaluated in the system, and all those components have been included in the past and continue to be. So in terms of classroom strategies and behaviors, there are 41 elements. They're all observable in the classroom, and we give frequent feedback to teachers on those. And When you look at the iObservation tool, you're going to see that there's teacher evidence available on that tool, student evidence, there's a rating scale, and then there's a place for comments and coaching for the teachers. So each time there's a walkthrough or an observation, there's a lot of feedback that comes to a teacher. And we know that's what makes the most difference in performance, is to get frequent feedback. What's different than the previous model is that while teachers still have two times a year to put their best foot forward and have an announced observation that they know their building leader is coming to watch them teach, they also have lots of times when people are just walking in and seeing daily life in their classrooms. It's a much more realistic picture of the kinds of learning that is happening in our schools. What I will tell you that principals have said and assistant principals is they're seeing increases in the quality of the teaching going on in classrooms as teachers are receiving feedback. Already, we're seeing some growth, and that's been very exciting. So what I'd like to do for you now is give you the opportunity for a little practice, and I'm going to need some help from Anna to make sure. It's going to be a little clunky. We've got to get on the website, and I couldn't log in ahead because it would log me out by the time I was up here, so we're going to need to work together on this. The screenshot that you see up here is what a principal or a teacher sees. Thank you. What our leaders see as they log in, and I'm going to try to get the cursor. There's a drop-down for observations, an opportunity to collaborate. A teacher can initiate a conversation, or a principal can initiate a conversation, or it can be a one-on-one conference, or it can be a group dialogue, but we can invite people to communicate with each other. There's a place on here for growth plans. There's a wonderful resource library, which I will be using this evening to show you a video. We also have reports that are available that our leaders can download. And then this is the drop-down that teachers use. I won't pull this down because I don't have a teacher's information to share with you. But teachers can see the ongoing status of their evaluation. Every day they can click on here and see how the points have accumulated and what their evaluation score looks like. Very soon we're going to have another little drop down right here that says leadership. And our principals and assistant principals will use this same tool in their evaluation. So the iObservation software that we already purchased, we'll just get one more link added and we'll be able to use it for our administrator evaluations. I'm hoping that you have a sheet that looks like this in your materials, without my scribbles on it, but this is an example of an element, and that is element 14, reviewing content, and I am going to pick that up off of the iObservations. I'm going to go under here under conduct an observation, and I'm going to bring up, I get practice teacher as my first teacher because when I go out in schools, I always work with practice teacher so that I'm not accidentally sending feedback to someone. When a principal pulls this up to give feedback to a teacher, these are all the 41 elements that they see available to give feedback on. And as we go into a classroom, the first thing we ask ourselves is, what is happening in that classroom? And we look at this middle column, because this middle column is about instruction, the content that we're teaching, and we ask ourselves, is this brand new content that's being taught to the students? If it is, then we are going to be looking at ways that the teacher involves the students in interacting with new content. If what's happening is content that's already been taught and they're reviewing it and deepening understanding, we look at these elements. And if the students have been taught this information and they're now at a place where they're applying and generating hypotheses, we're looking down here. The lesson that you are going to see a little snippet of is a teacher who is reviewing content, and I'll pull that up in just a moment. The other aspects here, we have learning goals and scales, which is something a teacher can post and talk about with students anytime they're teaching or tracking their progress. We also have how teachers establish routines in the classroom. We can always give feedback to teachers on that. So these are things that are routines in the classroom that we can continue to give feedback to teachers. The lesson segments enacted on the spot are the ways we engage students. And there are several aspects here that a teacher could be given feedback on in terms of engagement strategies. We also have the strategies teachers use to make sure students do follow the rules in their classroom. We have strategies for maintaining relationships with students. It's one of the things I remember Mrs. Sharma talking about early on when we went to this evaluation tool is, you know, what about the relationships between a teacher and a student, and aren't those things important, and what about the art of it? Those things are recognized in this instrument. And then how we communicate high expectations for all the learners in the classroom. So the video you are going to get to see in a moment is a teacher of sixth grade. He is a social studies teacher. And you're going to see a little over 3 minutes of time in his classroom. And he will be reviewing content with students. So I want to open this. You have a hard copy of this. When we see someone reviewing content, we open this up and we look to see which things we see the teacher doing. So become familiar with this. So as you're watching that 3 minutes, you can say, which of these things is this teacher doing? Is the teacher beginning the lesson with a brief review of content? And what strategy is the teacher using? And here are some examples of strategies that a teacher could use. Now, what we want you to know is the teacher may use a different strategy that's not listed here. That's okay. These aren't meant to be the only thing a teacher could do, but examples of what a teacher could do. And then with each one of our rubrics, we look at what the evidence is that students are doing. And so we're looking to see if students, when asked, can describe the content on which the new lesson is based, and that they respond to the activities. When they respond, it indicates that they recall the previous content. So this is what the teacher's doing, what the student's doing. And then we have a scale. The scale that is up here is slightly different from the printed version you have, and I'll show you what's different. If a teacher isn't using the strategy, but they really should be, it's having a negative effect on learning because they've decided for some reason not to use a strategy, we might identify a strategy as not using, but it would have to be having a negative impact. We wouldn't just go in and say, oh, you're not reviewing content, I'm going to give you not using. It might not be appropriate to be reviewing content. There'd be lots of reasons why a teacher might not be doing the strategy. If they're doing the strategy incorrectly with some parts of the strategy missing, they're at a beginning level. If they're using the strategy, in this case engaging students in a brief review of content, that highlights the critical information. But the majority of students are not monitored for the desired effect of the strategy they are developing. And that's what's missing from the printed copy you have. It doesn't mention monitoring. Your printed copy also does not tell you what the desired effect is. But if you think for a minute, what would be the desired effect of the teacher reviewing content with students? What does the teacher want to have happen by reviewing content? The teacher wants the students to remember the content. Can they recall the content? So the teacher, to be developing, is giving the students an opportunity to review content. But the teacher isn't checking to see if most of the students can recall the content. The teacher's just going through the review activity. To be applying, which is the most, it's where teaching becomes effective, is at the applying level. Students, the teacher engages the students in a brief review of content that highlights critical information. And the teacher monitors the extent to which most of the students, the majority of them, can recall and describe the content. So this is where we cross over from doing a strategy to doing it with the most effectiveness. And then in innovating, the teacher monitors for the desired effect for all students and probably needs to adapt the strategy so it is effective for all students. So we go with doing the strategy to doing it and checking to see that it is effective with more than half of the students, and then making sure it's effective with all of the students. So that's how we come up with where on the rating scale a teacher is. What you'll also see on the rubric form is that there's a place for comments. And what the leader does in coming to the classroom is writes a sentence about the context, what's going on. Teachers reviewing social studies content on whatever the topic is. And then they give a reason for the rating they chose. So if wherever, whatever they decided was the appropriate rating, they provide a little justification of that. And then they might ask, and you'll see below your rating scale on your hard copy, you've got some questions that are reflection questions. An administrator could choose to give a reflection question to a teacher. These are examples. They wouldn't have to use these, but these are just to get the thoughts going. So if a teacher's at a beginning level, then they would ask a reflection question that would help them move to developing. If the teacher's at the applying level, they'd ask a question that might help them move to innovating, and that's kind of the idea behind that. So I am going to log us into a classroom. Let's see if I can. Okay, now I'm going to have to go back to, I'm going to take us a minute here. See if I can.
this down. Okay, I'm going to go into our resource library. Little cursor to go where it needs to go. Okay, this is our middle school grade 6 social studies classroom. When I click on this little video icon right here, you're going to see a little bit more than 3 minutes of a 6th grade social studies teacher, and your job is to decide how would you rate this teacher on the element of reviewing content. You ready? Okay.
What I've done is look through and see how well we've done on some sections and how we probably need to work on some other ones. You'll notice when we do our review packet, we're not going to talk about continents and oceans because you all know those. So we're not going to waste our time on that. This is one of the regions or one of the sections that we had problems with. So this is one of the things we're going to be going over. Now, what we're talking about very quickly, and we all know this. Now, we need to know all 8 of our regions for the SOL test. Now, the 8 regions we just saw, they're listed here. First one we're going to talk about, coastal range. All right, we know it's located on the west coast. It's west of the basin and range. Stretches from Canada to California. It's made up of the rugged mountains and the fertile valleys. These are our pictures of what the coastal range looks like. You can see the mountain ranges run basically right into the water. Not a lot of beach, not a lot of area for that gradual decline. It goes straight in. Okay, there's another scene of what it looks like. You can see right here, mountain range drops right into the ocean. This is where we also see our very large forests, those fertile valleys that we talked about. All right, next is basin and range. How do we characterize basin and range, Jordan?
It's like kind of like a desert.
Varying elevations, isolated mountain range includes Death Valley. Morgan, what is Death Valley? Lowest point in North America. Very good. This is an idea of what the basin and range looks like. Okay, you can see isolated mountain range, flat land leading up. Death Valley is the lowest point in North America. They get about inch and a half of rain a year. Okay, next is the Rocky Mountains. Jeffrey, what lies in the Rocky Mountains?
The Continental Divide.
Continental Divide. We know where it lies. It's rugged mountain, high elevations. What does the Continental Divide do, Hunter? Yes, it determines the directional flow of our rivers. Rivers that start on the east side of the Rockies go east, start on the west side, go west. Rocky Mountains, here's an idea. You can see high elevation, snow-capped peaks. Here's a map that shows you where they are. Okay, here's another idea of what the Continental Divide is, some of what the Rockies look like. Great Plains, Emma, describe them.
Grasslands that elevate westward.
Flatlands that grasslands that increase in elevation slightly to the west. Awesome. Known for their grasslands. All right. Nathan, there's some pictures of that. Interior lowlands. Describe it for me. The Great Lakes are in it. West of the Appalachians, east of the Great Plains. Lowlands, river valleys, a lot of hills, a lot of grasslands. This is what it looks like. You can see just rivers, hills, a lot of grasslands.
Okay, we won't play it again. I'm going to see if I can get us to the practice teacher again. So we're back to our observation form. Now our job is we've seen this in the classroom, and we need to decide what feedback to give the teacher and where we'd rate the teacher. So did the teacher begin the lesson with a brief review of content? If we believe so, then we click that little box. Did the teacher use a specific strategy to review the information? What'd you see him do to review?
This is not one of Kyrene teaches,
no,
I hope.
It is not. It is a video sample teacher. It's a practice teacher for us.
Yeah. I don't know how to rate it or anything, but he definitely talked too much.
Well, was he a well-organized teacher? Did he have a clear PowerPoint? Did he have good classroom management? This was a
he
focused
did use
classroom,
questions to review the content.
And he used questions to review the content. So he used that strategy, and we can click that. So when asked, students can describe the previous content on which the new lesson is based. Were some students able to describe some content when he asked questions? Yes. Did their responses indicate that they recalled the content? Okay. So we had all those things going. So when we go to the scale, what we've been trained to do is to start with developing, because that's using the strategy basically correctly. So let's just look. The teacher engages students in a brief review of content that highlights critical information, but the majority of students are not monitored for the desired effect of the strategy. Did he basically use the strategy correctly?
Yes.
He had a brief review of content. And how many students recalled the answers to each of the questions?
One.
And how many students did he ask each question of? How many students were invited to answer each question? One. So we don't know if the majority of students knew the answer to each of the questions he asked. We know that a handful of students, he asked probably, if he asked eight questions, we heard eight students respond. In a class of 30 kids, not the majority of kids, but the students he called on knew the content, didn't they? So he's really halfway there. I mean, it gave us the impression that he had taught this before, students had learned this before, but we can't credit him with monitoring the majority of students as he taught that particular piece of content.
Well, we don't even know if he chose the brightest students in the class to answer the questions.
We don't. And so when we rate this, we would be likely looking at developing, because to be applying, he needs to monitor the majority of his students to make sure the majority of kids can recall the content.
I have a question. What is the strategy?
The strategy is reviewing content at the beginning of a lesson. So a critical strategy that teachers can use is to review previous content as they begin a new lesson so that they know kids remember as then they're moving on to the new content. So it comes in that. It is a strategy that we see frequently in classrooms, but we want to see more engagement. So when we get there, what would happen in this one is we would hit developing, and then there'd be an opportunity to write some comments. What you'll find, and our school leaders would agree to this, their observation could have been 3 minutes. How long are you typically in a classroom by the time you do all your comments? Yeah. Our walkthroughs are about 10 minutes these days, which is kind of good because you get a bigger scope of what's going on in the classroom. But it takes a little bit of time to put all this data in. So when we've done that, the other thing, I want to go back to the table of contents. Because while the teacher was reviewing content, one of the things that the teacher did not do as good a job with was engaging students. So one of the strategies here, an example, is managing response rates. There are lots of response strategies a teacher can use to help engage lots of kids at once. And this would be an area we might choose for additional feedback for the teacher. So while there's a main element, we call them Dr. Shower. We call them dominant elements. One of the dominant elements is reviewing content. Another in this is how this teacher manages responses of students. If he'd had all students talking at the table with the answer, using whiteboards, there's lots of ways he could have gotten lots of kids to answer the questions instead of one student at a time. But that is a little look at this. And then when it's done, when the observation is done, we save it and close it, we finish it, and it gets sent automatically to the teacher, who immediately receives an email that says, there is feedback for you that's waiting. And they can log in and read all the feedback. and on a continuous basis get very, very frequent feedback. What I'm going to do is hit cancel because I don't want to send this to anyone, but that just closes that out for me. Questions?
You know, I think we're in a new era now where we have to, you know, it's a mandate. We have to show the accountability. However, you know, there's going to be that other side of it. And I think something that's been brought up, you know, that I've heard that's maybe not one of the more positive notes of this is that how are we addressing less skilled evaluators? I mean, there are some leaders out there that do a phenomenal job and the rapport's there and everything's a positive experience where, you know, I believe that there are different types of leaders and there are different types of people that can go into a classroom and really make it as a growing experience, whereas there can also be, and again, this isn't everything that we do, but with this, I think it's something that I want to make sure that we do address, is that you'll get someone who's maybe evaluating someone who maybe this person would actually, the teacher would be the better evaluate. I mean, how do we address, or are we addressing where maybe there's a weak link somewhere, or we're seeing a conflict, so maybe we kind of reassess who's evaluating. I mean, I know we're kind of in the growing pattern right now, mm-hmm. but that's just something that I think to make it a legitimate evaluation, or at least if I'm a teacher and I'm being evaluated and I have the utmost respect for you to come in to say, you know what, Bernadette, you could do a better job engaging the students and maybe we ask all the students versus, you know, getting this report and thinking, well, gosh, you know, I mean, and keeping the morale up because I think that's our goal. So, you know, I've heard a lot of positive things and I completely think this is the way to go that we have to go. But how, and I'm sure you're going to have some answers.
I can answer that question. Well, the 58 and a half hours of training in this instrument is more training than we've had on any instrument we've used. So we had administrators evaluating in the past without that significant level of training. We also had an assessment done by the Learning Sciences International Company for our inter-rater reliability. Every one of our administrators had to conduct that assessment. That's part of why we have buddies walking around with people so that we have the conversations in an ongoing way. We ask that principals and their assistants do some walking together. We have district office folks that are buddied up with schools walking together. Dr. Schauer and I are out walking together with principals. We practice in meetings. What our trainer has said to us is that we have an exceptionally high reliability rating as she has worked with us through the training. We are pretty much spot on as a group of 50 people at a time that we're seeing the same level of performance. Now, what's interesting, occasionally we might say, well, it's this element or it's this element, because there's some that are very close, but whether it's developing or applying or innovating, we're seeing it the same way. We have more reliability right now than we've ever, ever had in our system. That being said, if someone feels that their evaluation is off the mark, they certainly can go talk to their principal, they can talk to their KA representative, they can talk to their classroom practice mentor. We've got support in place, but we are closer to reliability, much, much, we are much more reliable than we've ever been before.
Good.
One thing I liked when I went through with Dr. Lesher was that I thought that she would be going in there and like was going to pick one section that she was looking for, and if she didn't see it, then the other person would have gotten a bad evaluation. But we went in there and, you know, we were only there for like 3 minutes per each evaluation. I think she did four. We went to four different classrooms. She said, okay, sit down. So she sat down, and after she gave it about 20, 30 seconds to see what was going on in the classroom before she started pointing to me, you know, what do you see in here that's going on? So she took her time to see exactly what she could actually evaluate on, not going in with a preconceived idea of looking for this, this, and this, and so that when she did the evaluation, it was, you know, very unbiased. It was just like, this is what's going on in the classroom. Okay, this is what I'm going to evaluate on, which I was surprised. I didn't know that's how they were doing it. I thought, you know, we're looking for this certain thing. If you didn't see it, then
we're looking to see what's going on in the classroom at that moment and what's the dominant thing that's happening that we can give the teacher feedback on. The other thing that I would add to this, Bernadette, is that that rubric is more specific than other evaluation tools that don't really spell out what the performance looks like. So I think we're closer to being consistent with that in place as well.
Uh, If we gave every teacher in the district a little handheld feedback machine, and we asked what the level of comfort is, or the level of confidence, or the level of stress, you know, what do you think we would learn? I know that several weeks or months ago there was a presentation that was done that there was some concern that this was causing stress among the rank and file. So has that improved? Do you think that we're moving in the right direction? Is this causing a certain amount of discomfort at a time that there's certainly no shortage of other things to worry about? So how do you think it's going would be a good way of asking
that
question.
I would say there is discomfort. I would say that there is some stress in this. I wouldn't deny that. What I will say is that as we get into the more formal observations, where the teacher is well planned, it's not just the walkthrough, where they sit down, they tell their administrator what they're going to be teaching and what elements, you know, they can expect to see, they have much more control in those instances. What we're finding is that in a planned walk, a planned observation, which is a whole class period, we're finding that our administrators are giving upwards of 10 and sometimes more than 10 different elements. They're giving feedback on that many things that they're seeing in that kind of a period of time, where the teacher has control, has planned, and they know they're coming. In a walkthrough, it's a couple of feedback points. So there's a lot heavier emphasis on the planned opportunity for teachers, which over time I think is going to decrease some of that stress. It's also just getting used to the fact that somebody walks through my room and gives me feedback. What I will also say is the feedback that we're getting on the website, while there is still feedback saying we're stressed, there is starting to be more feedback, not more than, I don't know if the balance between stressed and not, we are seeing an increase in feedback that's saying I'm appreciating getting feedback. We're hearing that from teachers. So I think we'll turn a corner on this, but it is stressful, absolutely. It's stressful on the principal because they want to give accurate feedback. They want to do a good job. They want to be in classrooms as frequently as they can. Is your work more stressful?
Can I add something to what you just said? One of the things that I think is helping is the teacher evaluation design team continues to look at issues as they come up, you know, and every time we have one, we always say, you know, that group really needs to convene and address it, you know. And so this is truly driven mm-hmm. by our teacher group, and I feel confident that, you know, they are advocating the things that are happening with the system. So I think that's really a good thing.
And we have taken direction from them. An example is one of those elements you can see all the time is that learning goals and scales are used, and teachers constantly, you know, go over learning goals. We're not ready to be evaluating our teachers on that. We're still learning about that. And the TEDT made the decision that we wouldn't evaluate those this year. It's a learning year, and we're just going to let everybody learn. So, you know, when we're meeting again this Thursday, we meet at least once a month. We go over what's happening and really support by either backing off or providing additional training. It's really taking our direction as we go. Mrs. Shama?
I have problems with it. You and I have talked about it before. I think the concept's really good. I can't imagine myself spending whatever time I had to spend during the summer to read the book and learn this. Unpaid time, all right? I don't know about the principals, but the teachers definitely weren't paid for all the time they put in, all right? Going back into the classroom, having my curriculum that I have to deal with, having many of these strategies of Madeline Hunter, which I've gone through zillion times, I just don't see 41 objectives, and I would have been much harder grading that person because as far as I was concerned, it was worthless. I don't think you could say a strategy is reviewing. A strategy is how are you going to get the most feedback from your children while reviewing? How are you going to demonstrate that your children know what's going on? So I disagree with the strategy. I never would have given them developing. I just look at the new report card system where everything is online. I look at all the things teachers have to do. And, you know, I think I'd go crazy because the one element that's the most important is teaching the children in your classroom. And I don't know how they do all that. Gina and I have gone through this a million times. I am not against it. I am against the speed which it's being implemented. I think at the end of the run, teachers will be much more competent. But my heavens.
Well, there is a lot to learn. What I also want to say is there's no expectation that we see all 41 elements. We're not trying to see all 41 elements. You see what is happening in the classroom. If a teacher never does element 17, we're not concerned about it. You know, they with the exception of if their classroom management is challenged, we're going to have to help them with that. But in terms of the different aspects of instruction, there is no preconceived idea that they have to be doing any particular one of these. If they're not using academic games, we're not worried about that. You know, they need to make some choices as a teacher, which strategies they use in their classroom. And there are lots of effective strategies to be implemented.
Teachers are overachievers. And they're going to look at that, and they want to do what's best for children.
We are our own worst enemies.
Absolutely.
We are our own worst
enemies.
We put a lot of pressure on ourselves.
Yeah.
And teachers do put pressure
and
on themselves. Our leaders put pressure on themselves equally. I know.
Yeah. Now, I don't know when the leaders got trained, whether they got paid for training days.
Well, I will tell you it's interesting. Some of the training, most of the leaders' training happened while they were on contract, but the 713 teachers who've been trained in the art and science of teaching, the principals who did that training did that on their own time without, I mean, our trainers don't get paid to do that when they are our building leaders. And many of our building leaders went through the training and delivered that to people and got no
But when they get trained, they're getting paid. They're on contract.
Well, and the challenge we have, Mrs. Shama, is we don't have a contract for our teachers that's long enough for us to include this training in their contract.
Well, and
in
we
their
can't
contract.
Afford it. And otherwise, we'd give them pars.
If we could have them be on contract for this training, I know Dr. Knight would love to have a calendar that had time built in for teachers to have
but
this
I'm
kind of training.
But I'm just saying that that's
it's
a money issue. What?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, that's right. We do give people educational credits for taking the training. So that did give teachers.
Okay.
In the end, they will get compensated for that learning time. Right. Thank you.
Mrs. I'd Hirsch, do you have any comments?
I do have a comment and then two questions. I appreciate the amount of training that the school leaders have gone through to be evaluators, and I appreciate this presentation. To Mrs. Shama's point that the teachers are feeling more stress, not only in being evaluated, but the teachers that I've spoken to are, as Mrs. Shama said, they're overachievers, and they're working nights and weekends and summer to make sure that their teaching strategies are improved or they have additional materials and such so that they can not only align with you know, some of the new requirements of Common Core, but also the evaluation. So if ed credits is one way that we, not being able to pay teachers for the time involved in all of this extra work to be prepared and to deal with this, then ed credits is one way, and maybe the evaluation design team can look at, with administration, can look at other ways. Maybe there's other meetings that can be reduced, or I don't know what they are, but maybe you can look at other ways if there isn't money to pay for them for this extra time. Maybe there's other ways we can relieve their workload. So that was my comment. My two questions are, for example, if in the video, if that teacher or the evaluator came in and probably wasn't going to evaluate highly on or higher on the students being engaged, perhaps. But how do you know that 10 minutes after you walk out of the room, he doesn't do some engaging activity? I mean, you're in there for a few minutes or maybe 10 minutes, but the class time is longer than that. So does that teacher have an opportunity to say, hey, when you left, I did this fabulous engaging activity that I would have been rated higher on? Huh? Can you address that?
Yes, I can. We would expect there to be some engagement strategies fairly frequently in the classroom. If you know, reflect on looking at that video, there could have been engagement strategies used. There are ways to have more than one student at a time respond. And what I will tell you that principals are seeing is now that teachers understand, and the reason that monitoring and having more students respond is in this protocol, is because that is where achievement becomes affected. When we know kids are mentally engaged in what's happening in that classroom, more children learn. That is the whole point. And so what principals are saying they're seeing is that teachers are now incorporating more strategies for engagement and monitoring now that they understand it. They are simple, small things that we can do to tweak a lesson. And yes, we might miss the best teachable moment that teacher had that day and walk out and the best thing they did happened after we weren't there. But the purpose of frequent walkthroughs are that we have more opportunities to see them than that one or two times a year that they're formally observed. I don't know if I really answered your question or not.
No, you did. That was a helpful and informative answer. Thank you. My second question is, this was the evaluation system. Was that required by statute to be implemented this school year or the 13-14 school year? Can you remind me of that?
Initially, our plan was for it to be this school year. There was an opportunity. I'll let Dr. Knight address the opportunity to make a change in that and what we decided.
I guess I'm not clear. Were we required by the state to implement a teacher evaluation system by a specific year?
Yes.
And that was this year?
Yes, Madam President. This was the year where we were to adopt the teacher evaluation tool. There was an opportunity for a one-year waiver that would have to have gone before this board by September 30th, but the teacher evaluation design team, this was one of the topics we discussed earlier in the year, and we decided to move forward, but also suspending a couple of things that Dr. Taylor already addressed, like learning goals, for example.
Okay. Was there a reason why I didn't quite hear. Was there a reason why you decided to not take advantage of the waiver just to maybe get through a little more learning and practice and maybe have a little less stress?
Well, and I do want you to know that decision was not made by Dr. Knight nor by me. That was a decision of a committee, which is mostly a committee of teachers. And, I don't know if Dr. Knight can recall any of the particular conversations that took place around that because, it's been a while. But
yeah, we felt like we actually had quite a few opportunities for learning, and we also are treating this year, especially the first quarter of this year, as an opportunity to learn. We felt like we should just go ahead and get right into it. We didn't see the point of delaying it.
Mr. Robb, Ms. Sharma, and then Ms. Coggins. Oh, I'm sorry, Ms. Hirsch, you still have another question?
No, I'm just going to say thank you.
Okay, Mr. Robb, then Mrs. Sharma, and then Mrs. Coggins.
Well, obviously we've been hearing about this periodically. This isn't the first time we've ever heard of it. I think I want to try to, I think we all have our own beliefs about whether this system is appropriate, not appropriate. But, we as a board were aware of the system. We were aware of when it was being implemented. We've been told some of these things. I think the question that I asked earlier, which I guess I want to follow up on a little bit, is from a board perspective, we think that student achievement is an important goal, and we think that recruitment and retention of the best personnel that we can get is important. And I think the reason I asked the question about is the momentum going in the right direction, is everybody getting more comfortable, is really kind of orbits around the idea that are we enhancing or ultimately enhancing or compromising student achievement, or are we ultimately enhancing or compromising our ability to attract and retain personnel? And I guess that's the reason I asked the question, is ultimately, is everything really getting back to what we're trying to do, what our mission and goals are? And you know, I guess if you all say that it is doing that. You know, when we look on our screen here, other than the cartoons I've been watching, you know, it says that this is targeted towards specific district goals. And seems to me that everybody's aware of what those goals are, that you guys are, everybody's got the best interest of the district. And I think change is difficult. I mean, Mrs. Sharma says that all the time. Change is difficult.
Yeah, absolutely.
And, you know, if the momentum is actually moving in the right direction, and this is something we were certainly mandated by statute to implement, then, you know, from my perspective, we appreciate the update, and we have the great, and I speak for myself, have a great deal of trust in all of you who are implementing this. And I know that we all get to hear, not necessarily on Tuesday nights, but we all get to hear when things aren't going well. So I'm sure that if it's not going well, we will hear. But for now, I guess I would say I'm satisfied.
We will hear as well.
Yes.
We hear together.
Mrs. Sharma?
Yeah, and here again, all I want to reiterate is that the program is good. But I don't think we were dealt with fairly. I really don't, because I was always told it was a one-year phase-in, all right? And then when I spoke to somebody who was on the State Education Committee and he asked me what I thought about it, I said, it's a great program, but 1 year is absolutely ridiculous. And that's when he mailed me the literature from the statute that said it's a two-year phase-in. And I just think when you push that much change on somebody, all right, the quality of teaching goes down. Eventually, it'll go up. But you know that if you get 25 things new at one time, until you sort them out and figure out what works to your style and not the template style, it takes a long time. It's not, you know, and I just look at them. I hear teachers all over the place saying they're going to retire, they're leaving the profession. Now, I don't know if that'll happen or not, but I know that they're really frustrated.
Mrs. Coggins?
And, you know, just in closing, because again, you know, this is ultimately about accountability, and it's about, I know that being in the classroom is only a positive thing, and I've heard raves about that. It's good for the students to see their principals and to see that interaction. So I know there's a lot of positive going on. And I think that we're always going to hear the negative. And so I just encourage the teachers to feel empowered that they have the resources and they have the team, the district office, KEA, whoever it is, to support them if they have any concerns about an evaluation, an evaluator, that there are no repercussions, and that we're this year really, I think, a little more, you know, if we're right here, that we put the teachers here, like this gentleman on here, instead of saying, you know, would he be more developmental or applying, because we're building this to keep the morale, let's go a little bit over here and say, hey, I'd like to see you do this instead. And I think that that's just going to be part of the training, which I know you guys have done. So really, I think that's, as a board, I'm sure what we all want to see is just to know that there's that teamwork, and that if anything, we kind of migrate to the more positive.
Absolutely.
I have one more comment and request for follow-up.
Okay. Go ahead.
several people have talked about the teachers, and I know most people are aware of this as well, but this is a lot more added work for the principals and assistant principals as well. And so the follow-up is, while I can have faith that the administration is addressing those stresses for the principals and assistant principals and the teachers, it might be nice to get an update as to some of the ways that they're handling that. For example, if I know this to be the case, principals and assistant principals are spending more of their time evaluating teachers, well, it doesn't mean that their other duties went away. So how are you addressing the other work that has to be done or relieving some of that work? So not to say I don't have faith that you're doing that. It just might be nice for the board and the community to understand ways that you're addressing. You had talked in the beginning when you started to implement this that this was going to be the top thing to do to implement this year and how much work it was going to take. So,
you know,
I understand
I'll respond quickly to that. You know, and one suggestion I would make is that we have members of the teacher evaluation design team come to this meeting, you know, and speak directly with the board about the work they're doing and the decisions they're making, you know, because I think you need to hear it firsthand about why they've decided what they've done. So I think some of these questions would be really better answered by those folks. The other thing I would say is, you know, we are transforming our profession, you know, and I think sometimes we lose sight of that and we think this is just one more initiative and one more thing, one more program. We are changing how we educate students in this country. And these are the kinds of initiatives that school districts have to embrace if we're going to change the outcomes for our kids. If they're going to be college and career ready and be able to take the jobs of the future, we need to start doing things in the way we're doing them. And so this is major change, and we need to get used to it. That is what we're in at this point. And I would say to people that aren't up for this change, they should think about retirement because it is a lot of work and it's exhausting. And if you don't have the energy and the commitment and the enthusiasm to move forward, then you really shouldn't be part of this because it's going to require a lot of work. And as we think about resources for schools, I've had many conversations with principals about we have to find some ways to support those office teams at those schools so our principals can stop doing clerical work that, you know, so they can really be the instructional leaders that we're asking them to be. They really have no support. I mean, you know, we have great people in our schools, but we're so lean that they can only manage what they can manage. And then the rest of it falls on the principals. And they have to pick up the slack because they have to do whatever it takes to get the job done. And guess what? They're working till 8 o'clock at night. They're working on Saturday and Sunday. They're exhausted, and we all know this. And so what it's going to require is that our organization looks at our resources and figures out how to allocate them differently so that we can better support this type of system that's being implemented. So this is all major change, and it's going to take time to get everything in place that we need.
Mrs. Hirsch, I'd
exactly.
add a couple.
Thank you.
I'm going to add a couple of things to that, and one is that when we did our allocations of support at our schools, we never in the past have factored in how many people does a principal supervise. How many teachers are in the building. We've looked at lots of factors about students, but that isn't one of the factors we've looked at in the past, and it will be because it is significant now in the work of the principals. The other is that we do have some, I'm looking into some training for our school leaders that is a kind of a radical training about how to really focus on being in the classroom and really letting go and finding other ways to do other work. And it's a two-day training that we couldn't begin to do this year during this school year. It would have been useful, but too much on the plate. And so once we get through this first implementation phase of this new instrument, we are going to look at supporting our leaders with some new strategies about how to focus their work. We just couldn't take it on right now. So that's in the wings, and hopefully we'll be able to deliver that in the near future.
Any more comments or questions? Yes, Ms. Shama.
I don't disagree, all right? But I also think we're losing sight. I'm not saying the office staff isn't overworked. Everybody's overworked. Teachers work all weekends. They stay, if you look at the parking lot at 6 o'clock, they're still there. Office staff also. I know administrators are too. I'd be the first one to say that. But I'm also saying that if you slow it down, you will get to the same place with less stress.
Thank you, Mrs. Taylor. Next on the agenda is 8.0, the consent agenda. May I have a motion to approve the amended consent agenda? Correct.
Move to approve the consent agenda as amended.
Second.
There's a motion by Mr. Robb, seconded by Ms. Coggins. All in favor say aye.
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 Motion passes 5-0. Next on the agenda is 9.0, action items. These are items for consideration, discussion, direction, and a possible approval. First item is 9.01, policy manual change, first reading of policy GB. Dr. Schauer.
Thank you. These are a number of policy changes, once again, recommended through ASBA. All of these were initiated by our policy services and reviewed by our attorney and appropriate staff. And so they're here for a first read, and if you want to, we can go through them fairly rapidly like we've done before.
Do any board members have any questions? Okay, may I have a motion to conduct a first reading on policy GB, general personnel policies?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
There's a motion by Mr. Robb, second by Mrs. Coggins. All in favor say aye.
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 Motion passes 5-0. Next item is 9.02, policy manual change, first reading of policy GCCD. Anybody have any questions? I have a motion to conduct a first reading of policy GCCD, professional support staff military legal leave.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, there is a motion by Mr. Robb, second by Ms. Coggins. All in favor say aye.
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 Motion passes 5-0. Next is item 9.03, policy manual change, first reading of policy GCMF.
Move to approve.
All right.
Second.
There's a motion by Mr. Robb, second by Ms. Shama. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes 5-0. Next is item 9.04, policy manual change, first reading of policy GBAB. May I have a motion to conduct a first reading? Yes, Ms.
I know we're wanting to get through this. So with this one, it's all crossed out all the way down. Is that because we're not going to be using medical marijuana?
No, they actually bring it back on the next one.
Okay, so it'll come back.
yeah, on the next one.
Because I thought I was hallucinating here for a second.
On policy GBAB, basically we're asking you to consider eliminating this policy in the language. It will reappear in policy GBECA, which is the next one you'll be looking at.
Move to approve item 9.04.
Second by
second.
Ms. Shama. There's a motion by Mr. Robb, second by Ms. Shama. All in favor say aye.
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 Aye. Motion passes 5-0. 9.05, policy manual change, first reading of policy GBECA. We have a motion to conduct a first reading of policy GBECA, non-medical use or abuse of drugs or alcohol. Now, that was the one before. That was marijuana standards and conditions for
employees. This is where marijuana comes back.
This is where it comes back in this one.
It only left for a moment.
It's back. So is there there's a motion? Do we have a motion to approve?
So
absolutely. Motion to approve 9.05.
Okay. There's a motion by Mr. Robb, second by Mrs. Shama. All in favor say aye.
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 Aye. Motion passes 5-0. Last one is policy 9.06, policy manual change, first reading of policy GCK. Professional staff assignments and transfers. Is there a motion?
Move to approve item 9.06.
Second.
All right, there's a motion by Mr. Robb and second by Ms. Shama. All in favor say aye.
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 Aye. Motion passes 5-0. Next on the agenda is item 10.0, information items. There are none tonight. That's great. Next is 11.0, items for future consideration. Do any board members want to list any additional items? Okay.
Then we are at 12.0 meeting dates. Our next board meeting is in 2 weeks on November 27th after Thanksgiving. And finally, we are at 13, adjournment of the regular meeting. We have a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
There's a motion by Mrs. Coggins, second by Ms. Shama. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion passes 5-0, and the meeting is adjourned at 8:45 p.m.